For Christmas, my boss gave me this license plate frame, so I kind of have to drive around letting people know I'm a crazy cat guy. Whether that's true or false is the subject of this video. For the record, my money is untrue, and I'm never wrong. I thought I was wrong once, but it turned out I was mistaken. People call me a cat man, but I'm not like this guy, or these guys either. I don't keep cats or any other pets at home. I'm just a working stiff with the arthritis to prove it. At this place, I've walked through that door every day for the last 24 years. My shift runs Monday through Friday, but I'm here before 3 in the morning every day, Sundays and holidays too. Funny story, I once stopped for coffee at an all-night diner. At 1 a.m. Saturday, the joint's empty and the waitress, making conversation, asked me if I was going to work or just getting off. I resisted the urge to tell her if I was getting off, she probably wouldn't have to ask. Instead, I kept things for general audiences. I told her, I'm going to work, but I'm not going to work. This machine shop is safe haven for me, an asylum to conduct personal business on my employer's Wi-Fi, like managing my YouTube channel, my eBay and recycler accounts, marketing my ebook, see description and link below, monitoring my email, cyberstalking old girlfriends, and feeding and mending broken wildcats. The shop sits on prime real estate for feral cats. There's more than one colony on the block. Over 2 decades, I've entertained as many as 9, and always at least one. These days, it's just Gibson and Boxer. Too many, maybe. I christen them all with names that amuse me. Take Joan slash Jones here, for example. Joan had an odd marking smack dab in the middle of her puss. An upside-down broken black heart, bringing to my mind the rock band Joan Jett and the Blackhearts. Later, to avoid confusing Joan, I switched the name to Jones after learning she was actually a he. Then there was Six Toe. After all the inbreeding, every cat around here has six toes, but this Six Toe was the only one named calling any direct attention to it. After all, as a writer, I don't want to be confused with a hack like Hemingway. Now there's Gibson. First time I saw her forelegs, I noticed the paws looked like little black catcher's mitts. So as a baseball fan, I would naturally name her after a black catcher. I considered Campanella, the Brooklyn Dodgers Hall of Famer who was paralyzed in a 1958 automobile accident, but settled on Gibson in homage to the Negro League's Josh Gibson, all because a tiny factoid stuck in my brain tells me cats recognize and respond more readily to names with less than 3 syllables. Then there's Boxer, a regular 1-2 punch of syllables. As a kitten, his mitts looked like boxing gloves, earning him the title. He's the only cat I ever saw with opposable thumbs. Someday his offspring will build interstellar spacecraft, but today, true to his name and 4 years into his boxing career, Boxer is a fearless, ferocious fighter. Problem is, he's not a very good one. Or maybe he is. I've never seen the post-fight condition of his opponents. Either way, I've put him back together enough times to estimate Boxer has spent at least 5 of his 9 lives. Theirs is a rough life, but these wildcats seem to take it for granted things are tough all over, so they're at least mildly grateful for my handouts. They sleep under the sun and run under the stars to avoid becoming a coyote's moonlight dinner, and they wouldn't dream of having it any other way. Goddamn coyotes. Why these bastards are permitted to run free in the city is beyond me. The argument is, well, coyotes were here first, and we are the ones moving into their neighborhood. Well, so what? I've seen a cat with 6 toes, but I never saw a coyote pay a property tax bill. The other excuse has been, well, coyotes don't attack people. Well, it turns out coyotes don't attack people. That is, until they do, which is exactly what they increasingly are doing. Ever hear of the morphogenetic field theory? No? I discuss it in my book, so do yourself a favor and buy one. Shoot them, I say. Exterminate the brutes. Let the cops do the dirty work. Our police are already paid community servants with training in the safe handling and use of firearms, so issue them Ruger 10/22 rifles with Nikon Pro-Staff rimfire scopes and declare hunting season open forever. Seriously, what good are coyotes, especially compared to wildcats? Think about it. Feral cats keep the vermin population down, while coyotes keep the wildcat population down. And oh yeah, coyotes will tear your toddler into pieces, whereas wildcats prefer nothing to do with your annoying kids. Okay, full disclosure here. One of these bastards took one of mine just last year. I'm hard at work in my office one morning when one of the Rodriguez tells me en Espanol he just saw a coyote outside with a gato negro muerto in his boca. I grabbed a 1-pound hammer from the nearest screw machine and hit the street. I saw the dead cat first, a lifeless heap on the sidewalk. For some reason, the bastard was standing adjacent in the middle of the deserted asphalt road. In one lunatic moment during the showdown, I considered allowing the coyote his kill. It would solve my immediate disposition problem. But no, fuck this guy, I said to myself. I began walking toward him, walking and talking. I told him, this one's on me. Next time I take you and two of yours. I didn't elaborate on methods. My words were assurance enough of my means. And at that, the beast suddenly bolted out of hammer range. I picked up the dead cat. He had been 5 months maybe and too new on the scene to have been named yet, but friendly or brave enough the morning before to let me hold him. Yesterday he'd been light as a feather, but now he was all broke neck, dead weight, heavier and somehow larger, swelled with fluids that sloshed between my open palms like a half-filled black Bota bag. I buried him in a concrete planter box that fronts our parking lot, my furious shoveling in the darkness nearly shearing subterranean PVC sprinkler tubing I blindly mistook for a stubborn shrub root. In my experience, confirmed deaths are rare. There is only one other unmarked parking lot grave. Disappearances are many, though, and written off to bastards, street-racing jerk-offs, kidnapping in the case of kittens, or simple, born-to-run wanderlust. Injuries are more common. Take a look at old Tommy here after a run-in with something big, or something small with very big teeth. There is danger everywhere on this battlefield, and sometimes it even bleeds into the shop. One morning I found a rather large raccoon in my office helping himself to a kitten caboodle breakfast. I told him he was unauthorized, so he left without paying his tab. Medically speaking, the only real weapon in my feline healthcare arsenal is a spray bottle of hydrogen peroxide, which works well enough, provided your patient can be kept calmer than a seriously injured feral cat. A few weeks ago, Boxer showed up limping again, a rough night for the both of us apparently. When I got him under a flashlight, I couldn't believe what I was seeing. The fur and skin atop his hind left paw had been ripped away, and at least two puncture wounds were oozing white and green funk. The white funk scared me at first. I thought I was looking at bone. I was able to spray peroxide directly onto the wound a few times while he ate, but Boxer reacted with increasing anger and in protest hobbled out of the office. I followed him to the street and timed his 60-foot crossing in just under 2 minutes. Eventually, he made the cypress tree row and collapsed behind one. It was obvious Boxer could neither defend himself in combat or even flee from it, and forget about dodging street racing jerk-offs. Fortunately, Boxer has an outstanding healthcare insurance plan. I gathered him in my arthritic arms and carried him to a storage building on the property my boss also leases. Normally, Boxer would have resisted this lift, but he stayed one cool cat. He knew he was bad hurt. 1516 was a logical move, the perfect answer in that none of the Rodrigai ever uses the facility. Boxer could lick his wounds in solitude and safety for as long as necessary. He'd tell me when he was ready to rumble again. I visited Boxer a handful of times every day in this de facto intensive care unit. Sometimes he'd be hiding from the spray bottle, other times hiding in plain sight amidst the boss's machine shop and personal detritus. Either way, I'd speak to him, saying his name a lot while replenishing his food and water bowls Boxer. And cleaning his litter box.
Boxer. Boxer. Box. Where are you? Are you ready to...
Oh, wait. Forgot to mention the other cat that stays here. A black jaguar. 1985, I believe.
Boxer.
Boxer. Hey, Box. Boxer. Boxer. Where are you? Hey, there's my Boxer.
Hey, Box, how you doing? What do you know? How you feeling? How you feeling? How you doing, man? You ready to go? You okay? Let's get a look at you here. Hey, how you doing, Boxer? Let me see that foot. Can I see your foot? Can I see your foot? Show me your foot. Show me that foot. You gotta show me the foot. Hold on.
After 4 days in cat traction, his wound remained open and large, so I'd switched medication from the objectionable peroxide in favor of antibiotic cream and fortified his water bowl with drops of colloidal silver. They say on the fourth day God created the sun, moon, and stars, but on this fourth day, Boxer spoke to me. Not in so many words, none at all, actually. What you're about to see is an astonishing level of human comprehension and communication from a feral cat. It's so subtle I would have missed it completely had I not captured it on video. The scene opens with me speaking in calming tones and scratching Boxer's neck while he remains protective of his injury. After I ask, "How's your foot?" Boxer jerks his head into frame and stares coldly into my lens. When I then ask to see the carnage, Boxer gives a sublime right-left-right head shake, and his answer is utterly clear. Hell no.
Boxer, how you doing, Boxer? How you doing, Boxer? You better? You feel better? Huh? You look better. Not much. How's that foot? Can I see it? Nope. All right, maybe next time.
Did you see it? For me, it was the first mutually cognitive exchange between man and beast I'd seen since my divorce. Through it all, Boxer surprisingly seemed perfectly content with his lot. By day 9, the wound had almost closed, but he showed no desire to get back to catting around. I wondered if the steady diet of Frisky's canned wet food and cat treats had reduced him from an ass-kicking alley cat into a mere house cat. But the next day, he met me behind 1516's glass door, making squawking sounds I'd never heard.
What do you think, Box? What?
He was one step from freedom, but wouldn't budge, not even at my urging. The next morning, he was waiting at the door again, and this time, my encouragement liberated him. He moved aimlessly, squawking his squawk and seemingly unsure of what any of this had meant or what to do next. But he would think of something.
You want to go back inside? You want to go back to the wars? And so the great warrior returns to the battlefield. It's a great day to die, Boxer. Or it will be if the sun ever comes up again.
A postscript. I didn't see Boxer for the next 3 days. This wasn't unusual or alarming. After all, he was a young man with lots of lost time to make up for. When he did finally appear, he was favoring his right foreleg and sporting a shiner.
I can't see nothing. Gotta open my eye. Come here,
man. I don't wanna do it.
Come here.